about the basics of the requirement for information security management system as per 27001 standard and his family. So now I will talk about a particular section which is very important. Basically, heart of the ISMS system is a network security. So I will talk about the network security for the ISMS requirement. So network security, actually, we see that that network security comes under the domain A13, communication security. So basically, objective is to ensure the protection of information in networks and its supporting processing facilities. So now networks as security needs to protect the information against any unwanted access, to safeguard the data from any inappropriate delay in the route followed to deliver it to the destination and the desired period of time, to guard the data from any undesired amendment also, unwanted this modification or to guard our hardware like the hard disks, PCs, laptops from the attack or malware, viruses, etc., which can damage our system by corrupting or deleting all the content stored within it, to protect our PCs from the software which is installed can harm our system, as hackers do, to safeguard our system from Trojan horses, worms, etc., which can completely destroy our system. Because in a business scenario, we cannot work alone. We are somewhere we are connected, either intranet connection or internet connection in the world for the communication purpose, business purpose, either e-commerce or any email communication, internet communication, website browsing. We need to go to the public domain also. So that time, so there is a problem by other people may access your information, or they may attack your sites, they may hamper or damage your sites. We need to protect that. So that are network security. It comes for the requirement network security, Wi-Fi security, network security, access management, data loss protection, DLP, endpoint security, endpoint desktop, these connections are there, mobile security. There's so many lots of requirements are there to protect our network. So it starts from the physical network. You can see that our network can be either wired network, so cabling connection or wireless Wi-Fi connections are there. So there are both the system people using in the network architecture. So in a wired connection, the devices are connected to each other using cables. Ethernet cables are there, UPP cables are there, and the switches are for the connected to network router for assessing the internet connection. In our home also, we are also using some router and connecting to the internet connection to the cable. And there is a wireless connection also there. Wireless network device is connected to an access point. APs are there through radio transmission. These access points are further connected to cables, switch, or router for the external access points. So actually, that for network security, you need to take care of the physical security. Physical network layout diagram for ISMS implementation, you need to have a physical layout diagram of the your how the cables are passing, cable diagram, cable harnessing and marking, and conceal routing of the cables to protect against accidental or intentional damage also. If you have an organization, if a cable passes from one building to other building, so these cables need to be protected properly. Other maybe a accidental damage is cut, so that will be communication failure, maybe that availability problem, or there could be a leakage of information through that, so other unwanted person can access to that also. So these are the problems are there. Physical access control to network racks also. That's why you need to keep the network racks, firewalls are in the protected area to do access control. And also these devices are very sensitive to all temperature, humidity, power, cooling, etc. You need to provide proper temperature control, humidity control, power control, the surge protection, all these things are there. AC control rooms are there for the their proper function. So these are the physical network controls are there. And then wireless connections are there, Wi-Fi protected, actually WPA type of systems are there. WPA encrypts information because it goes in the air. We need to some sort of encryption, so that if anybody can also try to access your network, they will not be able to do it, or you know, to guess the passwords. So these are the different physical network diagrams are there used in different organizations. So these are the internet connection, the modems are there, firewalls are there, so network connect devices, wireless connect devices are. So this is the very first level, the network architecture. I will talk later also. So that you need to know what type of organization is there and what is the requirement. So what is the risk assessment out of that? So in the previous section, Mr. Bilaipan talked about the risk assessment. Risk assessment is nothing that what the problem you may face, like availability. So how to ensure the availability? You have problem of the confidentiality. When you have to ensure, it should not go to the wrong hands. So that's why you have to do some encryption or some type of ciphering, so that it goes to the wrong hand also. So they will not be able to see. That is a risk assessing or the disclosure of agreement, the disclosure of any network information. So you have to assess the risks and accordingly you have to implement the controls. So that's why network security consists of the policies and practices adopted to prevent and monitor unauthorized access, misuse, modification, or tampering, or denial of the computer networks, denial of services, network accessible resources. So maybe your company is running with a mobile, like this web applications are there. So if it is not available, your business cannot be done. So that's why your proper controls should be there at the network level. So network security involves the authorization to access data in a network, which is controlled by the network administrator. So there are different types of the users are there, their privileges are there. So they should be maintained by the network administrator. Users choose or are assigned an ID and passwords for their authentication. So we have talked about authentication, identification, then authorizations are there. So this is a very important aspect because the system knows the ID, who is entering that. So that's why you have to protect that through proper authentication and identification. The user should be controlled through proper authentication. It could be by, I will talk in later also, by password protection or the token may be there, or other biometric authentication may be there. So by that way, you can protect the network users. So if you see the in the network or internet domain, in public domain, how the data flows from the internet connections are there to the router are, firewalls are there, switches are there, the different multiple switches are there for big organization, core switch and multiple switches are there. They have individual LAN connections there. In the LAN also you have servers are there, your desktops are there, KVA, these laptops are there, firewall, these access points are there. So these are different. And the LAN connections are in the network, ultimately goes to the your office. The basic goals of network security, you see that. So the primary goal of network security is to confidentiality, integrity, and availability. I think Mr. Bilaipan just talked about the basic thing, CIA. So the functions of the confidence is to protect the PCS business data from unauthorized disclosures. The integrity is unauthorized modification or amendment. And availability is to make available to the information service to the legitimate users for whom your services are meant for. So that is the main thing. Confidentiality should unauthorized disclosure should not be there. Integrity should be maintained. So there should not be any unauthorized changes or modification of the data or information in the path or availability of information. And also, you before going the detail, the data can be stored in the organization in a rest. Or data may be going in a transit mode because communication takes place in the network on different LAN or WAN or internet. So there are either it is staying in the devices at data at rest or data at transition. You need to give the protection both the cases, whether it is a data is staying or data is transmitting, both cases you need to take the proper care. Then at the same time, it is not very safe. Also, the vulnerabilities attacks are there. The common vulnerabilities that exist in both the wired and wireless networks are an unauthorized access to a network. An attacker can connect to his device to a network to use an unsecure harbor switch port. So you have connected some access point, or someone is accessing your that networks produce sources to that hub point also. So that is okay in consideration for security risks also. In this regard, wireless networks are considered less secure than the wired network because the cables in communication takes place to the cable, so it is more secure than the wireless connection. But wireless can be secured through proper password protections are there, and proper encryptions are there, it will be protected also. So after accessing the, an attacker can exploit information vulnerability and different launch also. So it can be the attacker can sniff the packets, whatever information going through that channel, and denial of service one may be that so that the legitimate user will not be able to, like sometimes you know the hackers hack the site and deface that or that he would that something, you are not the legitimate users are not doing the, that is a denial of service attack. And spoofing of a physical MAC address spoofing also there, the man in the middle attacks are there. So there are different types of attacks are available in the network, and then these are vulnerabilities are there. So I will give some examples are there. The integrity, as I told, the unauthorized modification, and we have done intact accuracy of the data. What is the threat? Modification of user data, Trojan horse browser, modification of memory, modification of message traffic in transit. So what is the consequences if the some type of attacks are there? Loss of information, compromise of machines, vulnerability to all other threats also. So it can be maintained through the cryptographic checksums. So it can be controlled to some extent by cryptographic checksums. Like hashing of the systems are there. Then confidentiality. What is the threat? Eavesdropping on the net. So he is looking, unauthorized person is looking at your network packet. Theft of information from server. Theft of data from client machine. Information about network configurations, the firewall or router configuration theft. Information about which client talks to server. So these are the secrets are there that can be out to the malicious or attackers are there. So consequently, loss of information and loss of privacy. So when you are dealing with your client or doing the business with this bank or any personal private that can be exposed to the unauthorized person. So what is the solution? Countermeasures are there. So encryption, encrypting that data and using the web proxies on basically firewalls of the web proxies are there. With that you can also control the confidential issues. So denial of service, keep your user threats, flying messages with bogus request, filling up disks or memory, isolating messages by the DNS attack. There are different threats are there to which will cause that denial of service to the actual legitimate users. What are the consequences? The disruptive, so you will not be getting the legitimate services. Annoying, prevent legitimate users from getting the work done. So what is the counter? Difficult to prevent, but to some extent through firewall rules, anti-DDoS devices are there now. With that implementation, you can also protect that denial of service attacks. So this is the basically the network for defining your ISMS in the organization, for any organization, you need to first define your network architecture. So this is the first level information required for the organization for implementing ISMS. Who are your internet service provider? What are the guys, device, location, sites are there? Whether you require a VPN service are there? How much LANs are there? Whether any VLANs are there or not? Whether the modems are there? The firewalls are there? Routers are there? Backups are there? So all has to be indicated in the network architecture. So this is very important item in the organization going for the ISMS implementation. You have to first maintain the network architecture. You have to make proper arrangement for protection of the network devices and services. Then you have to act on it. And you regularly monitor. And also you have to carry out the vulnerability assessment and PT of the architecture also. And also if you see that security cannot be ensured in a particular layer. If you see that OSI, the 7 layers are there and TCP 4 layers are there. So security can be achieved at different layers also. Like in the security at the application layer. So if you see that the top layer is the application layer. So security mechanism at the top layer is security measures are used at the layer are application specific basically. Like your normal mails are there also, it's MIME, the secure multi-purpose internet mail services are there. So this is basically specific, if you use that particular application, that will ensure that a mail service is very secure. Then like email service will be secure. Then PGP, pretty good privacy, this is a auto communication channel for encrypted communication. If you have very secret and sensitive messages are there, you can use the PGP communication encrypted channels are there. They are like the DNSSEC is another protocol at least they are used to secure exchange of DNS query messages. So this is an application layer security. Second, you can see that the different layer has got their own security features are there and different mechanisms are there which can protect that in particular layer. The security at the dashboard layer. Like if you see that in the bank side, you sometimes you see the HTTP and somewhere you will find the HTTPS. What is the difference of that? HTTPS is a secured site. Whenever in the HTTP, your client to server message goes in the clear text version. Whenever you type your password or any identification, so that goes in a clear text. Like if your bank site or you are giving the user ID and password, that will go in a clear text format. But anybody, the malicious attacker, sniff the packet, you will be able to identify that what are the communication being going through that channel. But if you use the HTTPS, so that is an encrypted channel. HTTPS channel is an encrypted channel. So that is protecting the communication at the transport layer through SSL or TLS. So that's why you see that instead of HTTP, you will find that HTTPS. So that port, this HTTP is the port is 80, but HTTPS is the port 443 is there. Then also there is some people are using network layer security also there. So that is to done through IPsec and also SSL PPN. There are two schemes are there, IP security and the network layer. These are the take and there can be applied to all applications. Like in this in the PGP or the other things, they were taking an application layer, but this network layer takes care of if you use the IPsec protocol, it will protect all the communication in the network layer. So these are the security at the different layer in the network. Now, the one important thing is that if you go for a ISM implementation organization, you should go for an active directory service because whenever you define your different security policies, whether policies are will be deployed across the organization. So that if you left to the individual users, so they may or may not. So that's why people are using ADS services, active directory services, where we can define the security policies and all the machine will be deployed according to the ADS rule. So nobody can bypass that because that will be under the control of the administrator and all the machines in the user domain will be using that and they will access in the domain. So all the domain policy implemented in a single point and then better control through the active directory service, ADS, domain controller. So different organization using the ADS services, whether it's single location or multi location, so different ADS services are there. So that way you can control better way in the ISMS organization. So this is the different depiction of the ADS service in the organization. So depending on your type, group, you can different break up also ADS locally or remotely, you can do the ADS control. Then next level is the network devices, because network work on the basis of the hardware is the router. Router and firewall, these are the security devices. So when you for bigger organization, you need to communicate with different network, you need to have a router in the organization. So that will give you the communication from one network to other network. So router connects networks, for example, connecting a private network to internet. A router acts as a dispatcher, choosing the best path for the information to travel. Routers connect users to the, this is basically layer 3 network. If you see that OSI, this is a layer 3 device, the routers. So routers connections, there's a symbols are there. So router, the routing table is very important. Here routing table is protected. And there are different protocols are there, RIP and dynamic routing protocols are there, RIP, IEC. So OSPFs are different routing protocols are there. So this to be need to be maintained and protected. So actually for this device also, this is a security device, we require also some sort of certification in HTPC. We carry out the common criteria validation of these devices where the boundary protection devices like firewall, routers are being tested and certified also before they apply to the network devices. Next is the firewall. So the first device is a router and second is the firewall. Firewall is basically access control devices. It allows a specific type. It not allow all the traffic. Whatever rules will allow, so depending on the rule, it will allow the packets will be legitimate. The packet will go inside the internet network and other packet will be dropped at the gateway. This is gateway device. Firewall inspect the traffic rate, allows traffic specified in the policy. So whatever the rules are there, according to the rules, what the IP addresses, what the applications are there, what the ports are open. So actually firewall does it. If you see that the IP ports are there, normally blocked. Only those applications required to open for communication in the external world, those ports will be open to this policy. So that is by the configuring the policies is important. So unwanted, all the ports should be closed. Only the required need-based ports should be open only for the communication to the external world. Otherwise, if you keep the port open, so that will be a point of vulnerability in the actual network applications. So there are packet filters are there, proxies are there. This is basically protect the internet and the internal networks. LANs are there. So if you protect the unwanted packets, will drop at this layer. So if you see that internet, DMZ or demilitary zones are there. The fire internet host can access the DMZ and internet. External host can access DMZ, not internet. DMZ host can access internet only. And what are the advantages? If a service gets compromised in DMZ, it cannot affect the internal host. So internal host is protected by this firewall. If something is happening at the DMZ, it will not percolate inside the network. It will be protected by that. So this is a normal diagram for the how the firewall works in an internal organization. So if internet is a public domain, then firewalls are there, web servers are there, and internet, your LAN services are there, all the resources are there under the internet. And there are different types of attacks are there, as I told initially. So denial of service is one of the attack which causes the unavailability of services to the legitimate users. Making network services unusable easily by overloading the server or network. Many different kinds of DDoS attacks are there. The SIEM flooding, HTTP SIEM flooding is there, UDP flooding is there, SMARP attack is there, distributed DDoS attacks are there. So these are different types of attack are faced by the network in the actual life. So before going that, the different attacks are there. There are two types of attacks are there. One is the active attacks and the one is the passive attacks are there. So in the passive attacks, only they seize the information, interception of the messages, sniffing. What you can attack to do, use information internally, hard to understand, release the content, cannot do understood, traffic analysis also. So internally passive, you're not doing harm, but only looking into the information already passing to the network. So that's why you can protect it through the VLAN. I'll talk in later, say, through VLAN, you can also protect to the passive attacks also. So different virtual LANs are there, so that one network is isolated from other and separated through VLAN services. Then there are different active attacks. The attacker actively manipulates the communication, masquerade, pretend as a someone else, and possibly to gain more privileges. Replay attack, passively capture the data and send later also. Some session capturing and replay attacks are there, one of the important security threats are there. Denial of service, prevention of normal use to servers and end users on network itself. So there are different attacks are there. So these are the different denial, modification, SQL injections are there. So the malicious attacker injects some information in the network and tries to modify, amend, or unauthorized change of the information in the databases. So these are the different attacks. And one important aspect, the attack surface, how the attack can take place. What are the exposed portions are there? Attack surface consists of the reachable and exploitable vulnerabilities in the system. So if there is a port open, so that is the point of attack. Open ports on the outward facing web and other servers and code listening to those ports. Like there is a firewall blocks, all these open ports are there. Only application ports are open, other ports should be blocked. Service available in the firewall. Code that processes incoming data, email, XML, office document, etc. through the virus and all this comes to the email also. So that's why when you receive some mail, don't click the attachment also. That can contain some unwanted, maybe directed to go unwanted places or websites also, or maybe some information, virus or a malware may be installed in your system also. So no, never click any unwanted mail or unknown link also. Interface and waveforms also. Different website, if you see the web pages, different dynamic pages are there. So that's why mostly these pages are vulnerable. So the attacker use those dynamic pages for like SQL injection and other things. So exploit that and attack surface is open there. An employee with access to sensitive information vulnerable to social engineering also. This is important. So social engineering is a deception. The deception technique to get more information of the private of the organization, like the policy of the organization or password or any sometimes OTP also. So they through some manipulation or deception technique, they get some information about through social engineering. So this was this can be done to the proper awareness of the employees or the insiders to let them know what to do and what not to do. Those type of practices that will prevent those type of attacks. So there are network attack surfaces are there, so that prevents. So there are different surfaces are there. Human attacks, attack surfaces refers to vulnerabilities created by personnel or outsiders. So social engineering are inside the traitors also. Sometimes because in your organization, some external person also coming, like repair engineer, AMC engineers are there, service engineers are coming. So they are the point of the attack also. So that's why. So this can be protected by NDA, non-disclosure agreement. Or you have to, every time you have to escort it, not allowing to give a particular position in the organization, not leave them alone in the server room. So they can be a point of the attack also, by let us say. So we need to proper NDA signing and proper surveillance and escorting the external personnel while they will access, process your IT infrastructure facilities. You have to monitor proper. Then that is about the policy-based, procedure-based. Now you need to have some system or inbuilt that will detect if either somebody is trying to push information or mail packets in the organization. So there is a system called intruders detection systems. Ideas are there. So that will detect if some unwanted packets are there. It will detect and give an alarm to the system. And IPS intrusion prevention system also. So if there's if you install a system IPS, it will block the attacks. Also, it will scan the network traffic and whatever malicious packets are there, it will drop. So the secure the your network from entering the huge information or mail packets inside the organization. So this is a scenario for the denial of service attacks. So this is a perpetrator is there and they have hacked these devices and this is a victim services and they will see send the echo, reply echo. So this system will be overwhelmed with some echo reply and the normal function will block there. So legitimate user will not be able to work because of the denial of service attack. So these are the one of the very simple attack, ICP echo reply attack. Now, as I told initially, so there are different mechanisms for the protections of your network services. One is the authentication. Authentication means whether you are a legitimate user or not. You have to claim, like if you go to office, you have the identity card. You have the security gate, you show your identity card, they will allow it. Like in the distance systems and applications, how they identify whether you are a legitimate user or not, we have given the password. Your user ID is there. And if you enter the password, correct password, the system will allow it. So that is the password, is the authentication or credential by which the system will identify you are the correct person. Sometimes one factor may not be sufficient also. So there you require multiple factor authentication. So there may be a digital certificate may be there, token, RSA token may be there, or software token may be there, or biometric information may be there. So system wants more confirmation whether you are the real person who is going to access the system or not. So that is the authentication is done, multiple channel of confirming the whether you are the right person of that user ID or not, through password, through token, through digital card, certificates are there. So through that, the system will confirm. Then the system will allow you to enter in the system. So this is called multi-factor authentication. So there are different schemes are there, like password schemes are there, the tokens are there, then RFIDs are there. Then there are so many iris scans are there. So that way, these are all authentication devices. By that system will identify the correct person or not. Then there is a requirement authorization. Authorization means access control. Basically, what are the privileges? When you access to device, whether you are a normal user or a administrator or guest user, that will be done through the authorization. Which role you are having, which role has been given, granted to you. So that is through offer access control, that is authorization. So authentication allow you to go to a system. Authorization gives the rules and what are the permissions given to a system with the authorization. Then this type of the network device is also remotely controlled also. That is through radios and trackers are there. They authenticate the users, but the switches, servers are there. That is done through the radios and trackers protocols are there being used for the remote authentication. And also now the one system started federated identity provider. Like we have a user, but that your credential is maintained by other organization, like Aadhaar, UIDAI. They maintain your biometric or iris scan. And whenever you want to go to any card, a bank, or any telecom services, they will verify your services. So this is called federated identity provider. This type of things are there. Your user authentication credential are maintained by a third party organization. So whenever you go to the application, they will direct to that the third party service provider for proving your claimed identity. That is called federated identity provider. And if you see that the standard as 27001, there is a requirement of network control. As I told initially, networks have been managed and controlled to protect information in systems and applications. So in the network system, if it is running, different applications are there, the systems are there, websites are there, we need to maintain the proper security. Operational responsibility for networks should be separated from computer operations. Establishment of responsibility and management of remote equipment, sometimes for management or administration or monitoring for remotely, and special controls to safeguard the confidentiality and integrity of data passing over the public network. Because nowadays, because of this pandemic situation, and people also using the working from home, so people they are being guaranteed the VPN, virtual access. So those cases, you need proper identification, authorization, and security control so that a remote access can be granted, because they are accessing your company resources through public domain. So that VPN that they're using, the proper authorization and checks should be there so that they're given the permission to access your internal resources from a remote place. So that has to be properly controlled. So network monitoring should be there to detect attacks and analyze traffic. Restrict the routing to specific network addresses only, because also whenever there is a scheme is that whenever you connect your company resources, whether you are using your own laptop or that is given by the organization, because if you use your company authorized laboratory, then there is a mechanism for binding. So your MAC address of the system already entered in your system. So first that device will change, that network will check whether you are being the correct device or not. So device level authentication is there. So that will give them then access. If you are not using the company the devices, so there is a requirement to all the security applications to be maintained then you will be given the access to the organization. So this is very one of the important aspect while working from the remote places. And also encryption of transmitted data to retain confidentiality. Whenever you do any remote action also, that should be encrypted. Channels should be there, let's say VPN channel, so that whatever information passing to the channel or the network, that should be confidential and nobody can be intercepted. Then requirement or statement is that security mechanisms, service levels and management requirements of all network services shall be identified and included in network services agreements, whether these services are provided in-house or outsourced. So whenever you give some outsourced services, so that's the properly controlled through the NDA. You are going to sign a non-disclosure agreement with the outside party. So for who will perform on behalf of you. So you have to monitor their performance. You have to check their an identification of the SLA. Service level agreement should be there. All the services, security has to be maintained there. Like service network services like authentication and encryption, it has to be monitored on a regular basis. Regulatory monitoring and audit on the ability of the network service provider. Whenever you're giving the third party contact, you need to monitor their performance and network service provider on a regular basis. Then the control statement, if you see that in this, this all from the this 27001 domain A13 a control statement, the groups of information services, users and information services shall be segregated on networks. This is very important. Whenever that will be maintained through network architecture, whenever big organizations are there, so there are different departments are there, finance is there, HR is there, productions are there, then maybe other billing sections are there. If you have a flat land, if something happened, all the network will be immediately choked. So that's why people are suggesting there should be segregated network. But depending on activity wise, you can divide the separate domains. We call VLAN, VLAN, virtual LANs are there. So that if something problem, you can immediately isolate that particular portion and can isolate and control that. And that is one thing for controlling the virus proliferation in the spreading in the organization. And also for the security purpose also. So nobody can sniff your network because one user from other domain cannot sniff the packets because it is isolated and you cannot have the access to go to the other's network to sniff. So that's why.
Sir, sorry for interruption. Have you changed your slide?
Hello?
Sir?
Haan, bolun.
Aapne ki slide change korechen apnar?
Haan, kochi to dekhte pachhen na?
Na, na, kono movement hocche na slide e.
কোনটা দেখছেন না ও এখন এত কো দেখতে পারলাম না
না না না আমি
বলবেন তাকে দে আরে আমি যতক্ষণ দেখি গেলাম তো সব দেখতে পাচ্ছেন যাচ্ছে
প্রেজেন্টেশন মোডে করে দিন
হ্যাঁ প্রেজেন্টেশন মোডে বলেছি হ্যাঁ এই এতক্ষণ দেখতে পাননি এখন দেখতে পাচ্ছেন
হ্যাঁ স্যার কিন্তু প্রেজেন্টেশন মোডে করুন স্যার
হ্যাঁ প্রেজেন্টেশন মোডে বলেছি হ্যাঁ এগুলো দেখতে পেয়েছিলেন আরে আগে আমি আজকে বলবেন তো ওগুলো আমি দেখতে পাচ্ছি না সঙ্গে সঙ্গে এখন
হ্যাঁ এবার হচ্ছে
হ্যাঁ ঠিক আছে তো আমি তাহলে একবার স্লাইড দিয়ে দেখে দিচ্ছি যেগুলো দিয়ে গিয়েছি হ্যাঁ এই সে আচ্ছা দেখতে পাচ্ছেন মানে সব নেটওয়ার্ক আর্কিটেকচার
হ্যাঁ স্যার হ্যাঁ স্যার
আচ্ছা নেটওয়ার্ক I just giving a quick eglo I will discuss physical network architecture data flow th threads, network architecture. So this is seen security at different attacks and different layers. DNS poisoning, phishing attacks are there, SQL injections are there. ADS, Active Directory Services. Network device, router, router configuration, firewall services. Firewall configuration, the DMZ. Then how the firewall works with between internet and intranet, how to separate. Then different attack scenarios are there, passive attack and active attacks. Denial of service attack. So the malicious attacker, he gave some information and he tries to give some ICMP echo to the victim. And by that victim will be getting a lot many of the echo reply and will not be able to work. This is called buffer. Then authentication services. So these are different devices. RSA tokens are there for the authentication. Iris, this fingerprint devices. Then secure cards are there for authentication. Radius and attack asset tool. Then the federated identity provider. UDI maintained for the third party. Then I will talk of the network segregation. So this is the visible. Sushi is there?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now I just started. Network segregation. Network actually for big organization, like there may be a different sections are there. Billing section, then purchase sections are there. The HR sections are there. Individual sections have their own virtual LANs are there. So that one person sitting this domain cannot access other domains information. So that will be protected. And also if there is some person is getting affected by the virus, it can be immediately isolated. So this is the segregation of network. Then VPN, virtual private network. We are using in the pandemic situation, working from home. We are giving the virtual connection to the basically tunnel. So employee is there, employers, VPN clients are there, encrypted channels are there, and all the company resources, database, applications are there. So the person sitting from his house, he can access all the information to the encrypted channel, and nobody can intercept that. So that is a secure communication. This is a vibe, yeah? This VPN channels are there. It is connected to internet, but it is a separate channel. So through that, he accesses the internet. Now, so what are the different mechanisms for transferring information? Either through the email communication, FTP communications are there. So whether these are secure or not, whether it is passing any very confidential information or not. So that control is there as per 13.2 is there as per ISO 27001 domain 13. So requirement there is always a risk when the information or software are sent to other organization, as those may not be looked after the way owner wants to. So first is the establishment of the formal policy of transfer. How will transfer the policy? Like we want to business to one organization to other. So first you need to have the policy of transfer, whether you should the email or CD or any FTP or SFTP. So that policy has to be formulated. Compliance with the relevant legislation also. Because if some government has given some legislation, so you have to comply those rules and regulations also. Protection of physical media containing information in transit. Because if you transit some information in a CD, so that is lost So that information maybe goes public also. That's why what is the policy of transferring the information in the physical media also. That's what the policy should be there. The information policies and procedures are there. Agreements on transfer information, electronic messaging, whether your organization allows this instant messaging as there, or they are allowed social media, WhatsApp are there or not a block, because these are the channel to which the your information may be leaked to the unauthorized person. So you have to have a proper policy, like also information email policy, whether like in government nowadays, they don't allow the public mail, only NIC mail or government mail can be allowed for the government communication purposes. Like other web mails are there, so what the servers are there, how it is going, so no controls are there. So that's why it is prohibited or blocked or restricted use of the web mails. So that's the policy of the organization for using for the business purpose. You have to define your policy for the data communication, either email policy, internet policy, FTP policy, FCP policy has to be defined. Then the control statement, formal transfer policies, procedures and controls should be in place to protect the internet transfer of information through the use of all types of communication facilities. The protection of transferred information from interception, copying, modification, misrouting, corruption by malicious codes and destruction. There to be in line with the actually for ISMS, you need to define the acceptable use policy. So there in that policy, you have to define what is the policy for accessing on the internet, what are the use of using your email system, what is the policy of your other communication system. You have to define in the acceptable use policy. Consideration of risks of wireless communication, like some organization for very strict security requirement, they don't allow any Wi-Fi communication. The only cable communication is there, no wireless communication, mostly in defense and other places. So they don't allow some wireless communication in their sensitive areas. So that has to define the policy. Details of user contact and responsibilities, that can be agreement. Use of cryptography techniques to protect confidentiality, integrity, and authenticity. So that is be done through the VPN, virtual private networks are there. Use of various voice and video communication system also. Nowadays also, you know, the PCs are being used, video conference system. So you might be knowing that Zoom has some security problems are there. So if you use the Zoom, who is copying your communication or you never know. So that's why while carrying out this stuff by government or confidential issues, you should use a secure communication for video conferencing also. All so restrictions are there, policies are there. You have to comply those system for the video conference and voice communication also. The agreement on transfer of information transfer, whenever transferring in information to any third party or stakeholder, you need to have an agreement how the information will go. The details should be maintained in the information agreement. So I have told on the electronic messaging are there. So then there is a requirement for network monitoring. So initially you have to define the policy of network. You have to define the architecture. You have to make a proper implementation of devices and as per the architecture. You have to reconfigure the security of the firewalls, router configuration rules are there. Then you have to implement the different devices like the network monitoring tools are there. You have to see whether the networks are properly working or not. That is done to the IDS. Intrusion detection systems are there, monitors network threats from the outside. Network tomography monitoring, root analysis are there. So these are the different techniques for monitoring the network. So there are different network monitoring tools also available. So that provide five basic functions. Discover what are the IPs are there, what the protocols are there, map, monitor, and also give me some alerts are there and reporting there. So this NMS tools are there, network monitoring tools are there. I can give some examples also. So like the network mapping. So actually network administrator, you want to see there are so many nodes are there. So which nodes are working, which nodes are not working, if then problems are there. So using the network monitoring tool, you will be able to understand the what is the status of the network at a glance. So these are the network monitoring tools are there, mapping. Then these are how many these network sites, ports are, or these nodes are open, up and down. So that information available in this tool, whether any bandwidth issues are there, whether problems are there, that will be done and through this. Then network log monitoring. So that is very important. Log SolarWinds security event managers are there, McAfee Enterprise security managers are there. So there are different tools or ACM tools are there, security information and event management tools, SIEM tools are there. So they have all the features to monitor your network. Confidentiality and non-disclosure agreement with the service providers are there. Then there is a requirement for technical vulnerability analysis. So because whatever a tool you have deployed, whatever systems are deployed, so that is not the final, because this is security is evolving phenomena. So every time you need to update yourself, what are the vulnerability are reported, like you have, might know the SAT-in and SAT-s are there, the public are compromises of the computer across India and worldwide. We need to know all these security phenomena, like that ransomware or different the security problems are coming up every time. So you need to update your system and scan the system so that those systems are secured from these vulnerabilities. So vulnerability analysis of the network devices on regular basis, like there is a NESA scans are there, there are port scans, NMAP tools are there, NESA port scans are there, patch management of the network operating systems and applications are there, whatever router and other things are using. So these are using on a network operating system. So if they find some problem, they give some patches. So we need to update those patches on a regular basis also to analyze vulnerability and see what is the status of the system. And penetration testing to exploit the vulnerabilities. We have to perform remotely to see whether those vulnerabilities can be exploited. So there is a requirement of regularly doing on the V analysis, vulnerability analysis, and the penetration testing of the applications. And application security also there, whatever applications are running on the network, whether they're secure or not, so that will be checked on a regular basis. Then there is a requirement for BCP arrangement, business continuity program arrangement. So because in case of some disaster situation, how will manage? Because you some SLAs are there, you have to maintain the service at the disaster condition also. So some network virus attacks may be there, natural calamity may be there, because in this time of the pandemic situation, you are not able to access the office. So you have to work from home. Whether we have the infrastructure, we have the setup to carry out those things or not, that has to be ensured to the BCP arrangement. BCP, you have to take regular backup of the network configurations are there, system programs are there, and also regular restoration testing. So this is one of the important aspects for the ISMA. So taking regular backups of the system and also testing the backup on regular basis also, whether the backups are working or not. You have to be testing on the regular basis. And then redundancies in network devices, because if some ISPs are not working, you cannot stop your business. So there should be standby arrangement for the ISPs are there, or like your in network architecture, whether you have a redundant firewall, redundant load balancer or routers, or redundant topologies there. So if someone is blocked, other will take care immediately. So there is a disaster management system and called near and far. The DR arrangements are there, disaster recovery systems are there and not, that has to be ensured. Even also the power supply also. So that's why you can see the network racks are there. So there are dual feedings are there. If one power supply fails, immediately other power supply will take care of that. So this way you have to ensure the redundancy in the network devices and power in the organization. So racks should be maintained so that, and the architecture should be maintained for the redundancy. Then there is a requirement of endpoint security. What is that? Whenever you're carrying out some mobile devices, that should be having the endpoint security, or that will protect you from the virus attacks, and also some auto sandboxing with filtering and device softwares are there, and firewall. So all the devices are inbuilt in that. Mostly useful in the mobile and laptops are there, so security should be ensured there. Then there is a requirement of data loss prevention and DLP techniques are there. In the most IT organizations are there, there is a problem on the patent leaking or any information being carried out by the employees who are going to change the job or any espionage will be there. So they use some DLP technology to identify any unauthorized pilferage information or patented information are there. So that will be taken care of the DLP technology. So in the architecture level, so they introduce a system, any information or keywords are basing are there. So they block or not allowed to email or any filtering should be there. So that will block the information of a change, this leakage information. So then the requirement of network time protocol. So this is network time synchronization, because you have so many devices that connect interconnected. Each device has own time clocks are there. So if there's some incident happen, how do you know when this has happened? So there's a requirement of time synchronization that can be done through the network time protocol. Tools of the NTPs are being used in across the organization. So all the devices or the system should have the same time clock.
Sir, this is Anupam. Sorry to sir. This is Anupam. Actually, we have overshot the time.
Yes, just I'm complete. Just last slide.
Okay.
If you have any questions, please. So, in a brief, so network devices there, first of all, you have to define the policies. You have to have the network architecture, your physical implementation of devices. Then you have to regular monitoring of the network. You do need to have a validity and assessment and penetration testing, network monitoring, BCP arrangement and BCP testing. So this way you can implement the ICMS in your organization. So this is very brief, otherwise this is a big subject and each work required, a lot of activities are there in the organization and a lot of testings are required to confirm the effectiveness of the security implemented in the organization and the monitoring. Oh, thank you very much. Mr. Anupam, if you have any question, quickly you can ask.
Thank you, sir. I believe a question and answer. Let me check, sir, if there is any questions they have sent. Sir, somebody is writing, is ISMS applicable to any organization who wants to protect their IT assets and services?
I answer this. Whether this is applicable. This is applicable to government, non-government, private, big sort of organization. So whoever likes to have implement, protect their information security, so they can implement ISMS. So some department, government department are already in the process of implementing, already some implemented also ISMS in the organization.
Okay, sir, maybe there are no more questions. Well, thank you very much, sir, for your informative session regarding ISMS requirements in network security. This was very helpful for all the participants to understand.
If please go through the documents was provided, and if we require any further question or any explanation or anything is there, we are there. My email ID is there also to them. They can ask or contact us. We are providing the training and also we are providing the certification, so ISMS certification. HTPC is an organization which is providing the ISMS certification to the all government department and also private organizations, so they can take help of getting the certification from HTPC also.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much, sir.